This is a universe in which the most amazing things happen. So I'll give you an example. So if you have an electron, right, just in free space, that electron, as far as we know, is not made out of any finer stuff, right? So I mean, the electron is indivisible, right? That's what all high energy physics experiments tell us. However, imagine a lower dimensional, two-dimensional universe for electrons, and you apply a strong magnetic field and then cool them down to really low temperatures. Inside of this two-dimensional universe, that rule is very, very strikingly violated. So that electron can essentially split, it can fragment into smaller pieces that carry a third of an electron charge or a fifth of an electron charge. That to me is amazing.
It took a lot of thinking to figure it out. It turns out that the electrons form a state that's a liquid, but it's a quantized liquid in a very funny way. And the way that it's quantized is that they can make bubbles. Bubbles is like a place where you won't have electrons. And when you ask what's the smallest bubble that you can have, according to quantum mechanics, and that smallest bubble displaced a third of an electron. You cannot break that bubble down, and any charge fluctuation that you will see in that liquid will consist of several of these bubbles.
I mean, there's various other sides of this, which are also quite cool. But another really neat thing that's going on in this kind of universe is that the electrons have, in some sense, become knotted up with each other.
So when the electron splits into some number, say 3, in some ways, you should think about them as not just splitting, but like being little needles. And they have a string that goes back to the dawn of time for that system. And then when another electron comes and circles around one of those bubbles, it turns out that they're threads, not. You can actually keep track of how many times one electron circled another. The wave function is like a register of what's the knot that your system created.
Okay, so now let's talk about quantum information. So, you know, the usual problem with why quantum computing has proven to be so hard is that basically external noise from the environment is always sort of corrupting the quantum information which we're trying to so desperately to preserve in our quantum computer. So, for example, you know, a stray bit of photons might leak into the quantum computer. And if you're trying to store the quantum information in some local property of your system, maybe a property of an atom or something like that, well, that photon can hit the atom and then mess up your quantum information. However, these bubbles that carry fractional charge, which we were telling you about, they're called anions. The beautiful thing about this is that you can use their behavior to make a noise-free quantum computer.
So let's think about the setup. You have your device, and now I'm producing two anions. Now, think about the two anions being together as being some particle that has some degree of freedom that can be either up or down, like a spin, or maybe like a coin. But now you separate them, and then it turns out they still have that property. But you can't tell what that spin is when you look at each individual. In order to know what's in the box, you need to bring them together and then you find out. You can't look at this one or at that one separately and figure out what the information is. Therefore, you cannot disturb it.
The environment is still providing all this noise, but you no longer care because my qubit is neither here nor there. It's sort of in both places in an essential way. It's just a very clever way of storing the information, which is by default hidden from the environment.
It's like your computer has the perfect coding, the perfect encryption. Nobody can see it. So suppose you want to record something, like 0 or 1. Then you tell me what you want to record. So we make the two anions, we put your information into the vessel, split it, information is gone. But now we can manipulate that information by taking another two anions. So for instance, give me another number, we put them in another pair. And now we can make operations on those two by just taking one anion from one pair, another anion from the other pair, turning them around each other, then separating everything. We just manipulated the information.
Kind of like braiding strands of hair around one another, right? So you somehow take your anions and start moving them around each other, and that changes these zeros and ones that you're encoding in a very precise way that you as a user control, depending on precisely how you braided them around each other.
You know, the entire time the information is hidden. You're manipulating it by doing this, but you still cannot read it without bringing them together. I mean, you still need to engineer the thing, right?
That's the billion-dollar question, of course, right? It's just not easy. But there has been like a sort of revolution in how we approach the problem, which I think is pretty exciting. So we're figuring out how to leverage technology that goes into making ordinary computers so amazingly powerful, right? Taking semiconductors, and then modify those semiconductors to essentially force the electrons into behaving in extraordinary ways that we need to get these anions. Because it seems that we have lots more tools to bring to the table than we had even 5 years ago. That's what we find, you know, so inspirational, is the prospect of making these just new interesting discoveries about how the universe operates. And at the same time, with possibly applications that might allow us to solve one of the great outstanding technological challenges of our generation, right? Building a quantum computer.
You really just don't know what nature will serve you. You discover new universes all the time. The mysteries are just piling up.
Yeah,